probably the section on spiritual gifts that affects more people in this room than any other. And I promise you, for all of you who have come and taken part in our spiritual gifting evaluations, most of you came up with gifts that are very much service gifts, the kind of gifts that we're going to talk about this morning. Because the majority of the body of Christ is gifted in this way of service gifts. The majority of the body of Christ is gifted to be able to serve one another. The Bible tells us that we are to serve one another. And the Bible tells us that when one part of our body is hurting, then the whole body is hurting, that we should feel so very connected to one another. And with that in mind, you know, we bear in mind, I'm glad to see Ron Willamy sitting back there on his back row and in the service today, and I'm just so glad that he's back after so many weeks of being in the hospital, and I know you're glad to see him here as well. So we're going to look at Romans chapter 12, and this is part 12 in our teachings on spiritual gifts. Next Sunday is Father's Day. And so we'll not be preaching on spiritual gifts. As a matter of fact, next Sunday on Father's Day, I've asked Lyle Evans to preach on our Father's Day Sunday. So I'll be here and be in the service, but he'll be speaking. The following Sunday is a Lord's Supper day, and normally I preach on Lord's Supper on the days that we do that, or communion. So it'll be probably the first Sunday in July when we close out this series on spiritual gifts. Let's look at Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. I could preach a whole series from these first few verses, and in fact, I did that on some of the first Wednesday night Bible studies that we ever had here when I was pastor. But let's just read it, and I'll point out one thing to you. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. And the word good there is that Greek word agathos, which means that beneficially good, that beneficial kind of good. Not just good, looks good, tastes good, feels good, but good as in good for you. And when I explain this to children, I call this broccoli good. This is broccoli good. It may not taste like candy, but this is better for you than candy. This is good. And so Paul is going to talk to them about that which is good, that beneficial good will of God. Now, God's will is good because God is good. God can never have anything but a good will. God cannot will anything but good. And part of the good that God has willed is this good that we do for one another. It is God's will that we serve one another in a good, a beneficial kind of way. Look at verses 3 and 4. For I say, through the grace given unto me, to every man that is among you, that word man could mean person, because it's the Greek anthropos, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God has dealt to every man the measure of faith. For as we have many members in one body, and all members have not the same office. I want to say just this about that. When you understand grace, Paul said, I say through the grace that is given to me, then when we understand grace, we won't have a problem with thinking more highly of ourselves than we ought to think. Amen? When we understand it is all about grace, then we won't get caught up in thinking too much of ourselves. As a matter of fact, I just want to say this. If I understand grace, then I can better understand Gary. All right? And until I understand grace, I can't understand me. There is no way that I can function in a beneficial, good way. There's no way that my life can be a statement about the will of God, the word of God, the faith of God, without first experiencing the grace of God. And so I would say to every one of you here right now, before you ever get yourself all bogged down in serving, make sure you have first of all been saved. Amen? There's nothing harder than trying to serve God in the flesh. and without having first experienced the grace of God. Salvation is key. But he talks about faith there. To every man, the measure of faith. I underscored that because that's one of the spiritual gifts we're going to talk about today. Look at verses 5 through 7. So we being many, we're one body in Christ. Every one members one of another, having them gifts differing according to the grace that is given to us, whether prophecy, let us prophesy according to the proportion of our faith, or ministry, let us wait on our ministering, or he that teaches on teaching. I underscored ministry because that's one of the gifts we're going to talk about today. But notice this, we are members of one body, we're many, like individuals, but we make up one body. Everyone members one of another. Would you take a moment and just look up? Have you ever done what I've done before sitting in this auditorium? I look up and sometimes I ask myself, what holds those beams up there? I don't see a pole. I don't see a post. Do you know what holds those beams up there? What holds those beams up there is the pressure and support that they give to one another. And if you took any one of those beams out, then it would jeopardize the whole structure. Every one of those beams in place, giving their equal amount of pressure or support, is what holds those beams in place. We'll say that about God's church, which he likens in other places in the Bible to a building. What supports the building? Every one of us in place. Every one of us doing our part. So we're going to talk about ministry. Look at verse 8. He that exhorts on exhortation, he that gives, let him do it with simplicity. He that rules with diligence, he that shows mercy with cheerfulness. And notice I've underscored gives, rules, and mercy because these are three service gifts that we're going to talk about. So let's talk first about this service gift of faith. Look what it said in Romans 12, verse 3. This is very important. God has dealt to every man. That phrase, every man, could be everyone. It could say every person, because it's not talking about man as a gender. God hasn't just gifted the men in the church. God has gifted the people of the church. So God has dealt to every man the measure of faith. That word measure, from the very beginning, we started talking about spiritual gifts, and we talked about every part working to its measure, to its assigned capacity, to its full capacity. Well, let me say this to you right now. If you've been saved, then God has given you faith. Every single one of us have received faith. And as a matter of fact, faith is something that you can get all of it that you want. I like to call this book a faith buffet, because when you read this book, God builds your faith. There's not a place in this book that's not faith building. There's not a part of this book that's not beneficial to growing your faith. There's not one bit of this book that's not good for you, that's not going to grow you, that's not going to help you, and that's not going to strengthen you in your faith. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Every single Christian can have a strong, vibrant faith. But when we talk about the spiritual gift of faith, it's that special ability that God gives certain members of the body of Christ to discern with an ordinary confidence the will and purposes of God. I mean, they just have absolute, complete, total confidence in the next thing that God would have us to do. And can I say this to you about faith? Faith isn't always based on how. Faith is based on who. Amen? People who have the gift of faith do not always know how God is going to provide. They do not always know how God is going to act, but they always know who is going to provide and who is going to act, and that is God. Amen? People with this great gifting of faith are the kind of people when you're around them, no matter what the problem, no matter what the circumstance, they always bring it back to God. Well, God will provide our needs. God will make a way. God will be strong on our behalf. People who have this gift of faith have an uncanny knack for starting most all of their sentences with God. Amen? Now, I don't know about you, but sometimes I start far too many sentences with what? I. But people with this gifting of faith have that ability to start their sentences when they're communicating with the body of Christ, and everything begins with God. And if you listen to them and talk long enough, usually the sentences end with God, because He is the beginning and the ending of our faith. So there are people that have this gifting from God to never forget that it is all about God. And they have this uncanny sense of timing to make sure that we remember that it's not about the how, but it's about the who. We are here because of God. We are saved by God to serve God. And that is what this is all about. So faith is a service gift. But I want to show something to you real quick before we move on. Look at 1 Corinthians 12. Faith is also a sign gift. The Bible says, to another, God gives us faith by the same Spirit, to another, gifts of healing, to another, the working of miracles. Have you ever noticed how that is positioned right there in the midst of all these other sign gifts? Gifts of healing, the workings of miracles. Because faith sometimes can be a sign gift. God uses our faith to help us reach unbelievers with the Word of God. Look what it says in Matthew chapter 9 and verse 2. Remember that story when they brought to Him, Jesus, a man sick of the palsy, meaning he was paralyzed. He was laying on a bed, and Jesus, look at this next phrase, seeing their faith, He said unto the sick of the palsy, "Son, be of good cheer, thy sins be forgiven." Jesus saw the faith of who? The faith of the four men who brought this man to Jesus. Jesus, seeing their faith, now performs a miracle for the man on the cot. In Mark chapter 2, verse 5, Mark must have been impressed the very same way when he heard and understood this story, because he starts it with Jesus saw their faith. Luke does the same thing. He says, and when he saw their faith. And so we get an idea that faith then is more than just a service gift, but faith is a sign gift. When people see our faith in God and they see us act and live in such a way that is marked in faith, then they wonder about God. And they want to know more about this God in whom we so strongly believe. I talked about these beams. I worked with another church at one time that built a metal building, and when they reconfigured the way they were going to do the inside of the building, it turned out that there was a center post in the building that would come down right in the middle of the sanctuary. And so they decided that they would bring the engineer out there and see whether or not they could remove that post. And so they brought the engineer out, and the structural engineer, he looked at it, he studied on it, he thought about it. And finally he said, yes, I think it would be fine to remove that post. And on a certain Saturday morning, a set Saturday morning, the men of the church came out there, and we had the scaffolding, and they had the torch to cut that post off up there above the ceiling line. And I noticed something. I noticed when the man went up on the scaffolding with the torch to cut out that post, the engineer left the building. I saw that. He went outside. That was a sign. Amen? Will you say, Gary, did you go outside? No, I did not. But I prayed. And the only reason I didn't go outside is because the men of my church were in there cutting off that post. Now, some of you are saying, how foolish of you. But I had a lot of confidence in the studies that had been done. And I had a lot of confidence that that post was really there as a support during the construction period. And then when all of the beams were in place, just like this church stands without a post, when everyone was in place and everyone was applying the right pressure, that that building was not going to collapse. But I will tell you this. Faith is the substance of things hoped for. Amen? And I was a hoping. I just want to say that. You say, what would you have done if it had made a loud sound or started cracking or popping? I'd have went from hoping to hopping. Amen? I'd have been hopping right out the door. Well, a lot of us hop around constantly. Afraid of this, afraid of that, reacting to this, reacting to that. When the truth of the matter is that we must know and understand that the world watches the way we react to things. We say we believe in a God who shall supply all of our needs. We say we believe in a God who's all powerful. We say we believe in a God who's all loving. And folks, they see us in our circumstances in life, and they learn a whole lot about how real our faith in God is. Faith is a very important spiritual gift. And it is through our faith that people really get to understand and know how much we really believe in God. Let's talk about service or ministry. Look what it says in Romans 12:7. It says, let us wait on our ministering. Now, ministry or service, that spiritual gift is simply this. It is that special ability that God gives to certain members of the body of Christ to identify or see unmet needs among the members of the body. Somehow, others may miss it, but they see a need. They sense that need. They become aware that someone has a need way before someone else may ever even begin to think about it. And God gifts some people to see these unmet needs. Have you ever really thought about what happened in Acts chapter 6? And we studied about it in detail. How the Bible says there arose this murmuring among the Grecian believers. And this murmuring turned into a dispute because they felt like that their widows were being neglected in the daily ministration. That word ministration is the same word here for service or ministry. And they somehow sensed that some of the widows were not receiving in the daily service or the daily supply or the daily ministration. And sometimes we almost want to paint these people off as troublemakers. They were murmuring. But have you ever thought about this? What if they were gifted in this gift of ministry? And what if, although others did not seem to notice that there were some widows who were not being ministered to, these people somehow saw it when no one else could? And they went to the apostles and they said, we have to do something about this. And that's when God ordained the position of diakonos, or deacons, from which we get this very word service. You know, we talk about qualifications of deacons and we focus on a lot of different things. But can I say this to you right now? I think the number one focus, the number one qualification for a person who wants to serve as a deacon is simply this, that they are that kind of person that will not let unmet needs remain that way. Amen? That they want to make sure that the needs of the body are met. And I thank God for our deacon body. I thank God not just for our actively serving deacons, but I thank God for every person in this church, whoever has been a deacon, and for every one of you who one day will be a deacon. Amen? Sometimes I'd scare old Jamie Meeks to death. I say, Jamie, I'm going to make you a deacon. One day you're going to be a deacon. And Jamie, you look like a dancing chicken in the sideshow, man. Ho! But the truth of the matter is, that doesn't mean you got to come down. That means every one of us can serve in that capacity. To have that ability to just to see an unmet need. Some of you know you have that. Some of you come down here and do things that need to be doing and no one asks you to, no one directs you to, no one says, but you just see it and you know it needs to be done. And sometimes it's not just about the building, but it is about the people. And some people have that ability to see that this person needs something. There's a need there, and I want to go meet that need. That's what Martha was doing. The Bible says Martha was cumbered about much serving. Do you see that word serving? It's the same word that's translated ministering there in Romans chapter 12 and verse 7. Martha saw all of these people in that house. And Martha felt like every one of them needed to be greeted, every one of them needed to be treated, every one of them needed to be fed. And Martha was busy. She was cumbered about with much serving. Let me say something about service gifts, okay? Service gifts, when it comes to this idea of ministry, it is marked by people who are proactively seeing a need before it becomes a problem. They are preventively meeting that need before someone else has to go without. This is a very important ministry in the church. It is vitally important. Look what Jesus said in Mark 9:35. He sat down and he called the 12. You know, sometimes I got to say this. Sometimes we look at the 12 and we just put them up on a pedestal. Now, I know at the end times, the Bible says there'll be 12 thrones and the apostles are going to sit on those thrones. But I promise you, they didn't sit on those thrones while they were alive on earth. They were just like us. They were people. And Jesus was constantly having to call the 12 together and tell them something. Huddle up. And he sat down and he called the 12. And he said unto them, if any man desire to be first, the same shall be last of all and servant of all. Do you see that word? It's the very same word that talks about Martha cumbered about with much serving. It's the very same word that talks about some of those in the church in Romans 12 who have this gift of ministry or service. So can I say this to you right now? It is the most open, available, needful job perhaps in the church. And sometimes people look at it and say, well, but it's not a very high job. Jesus just said this. Jesus just said, if you want to be first, then you need to learn how to serve. Can I go on a little farther and say this? Jesus said, I am among you, talking about his life on earth, among those 12 apostles and the believers that were following him. Jesus said to them, I am among you as one that serves. Did you know there's no other spiritual gift more modeled by Jesus than serving? Not one. More than anything else, he modeled serving to us. And there is that ability. Someone says, I need something that needs to be done. I can see it. Now, there are many of us who are willing to serve. There are so many of us that if someone with this gifting can come and say, boy, here's a need that really needs to be met. Here's something that we can really do. And there are so many other believers who out of love and compassion and wanting to serve God will follow that and say, well, I'll help you. I'll do that with you. But there are some, and praise God for that some. There are some that don't just come to church and notice who's here. There are some that come to church and notice who's not. And they go home and they pick up the phone, or they go by the house and they want to understand why. Is there something wrong? Do you need anything? There are some that have that uncanny ability to lead all of us into knowing how to better serve one another. But let's move on. Let's look at Romans chapter 12 and verse 8. Talking about service gifts, let's talk about giving. Giving is that special ability that some members have to contribute material possessions to the work of the Lord and do it with cheerfulness. You know, there are some people that just love to give. But the spiritual gift of giving goes beyond just loving to give. But the spiritual gift of giving is so tied with that gift of discernment, that gift of service, because it means that there are people that see genuine needs. And you don't have to point them out to them, you don't have to tell them about them, but they just see genuine needs and they want to lead out in making sure that those needs are met, especially when they are financial needs. Notice what it says in Romans 12:8. He that gives, let him do it with simplicity. Can I say this to you about giving right now? This is the most important thing I'll ever teach you. Giving, when you listen to Jesus teach about it, giving, when you listen to the Bible teach about it, you'll understand that giving is not so much about how much as it is about how. It's how you give that counts. Look what it says in Mark chapter 12, verses 41 and 42. And Jesus sat over against the treasury. Now that word against there is the word opposite. There was a place in the temple where when you went in from the courts into the worship area, there was a place called the treasury. And let me tell you what the treasury was. The treasury was a trumpet-shaped bowl. And in the temple itself, there were 13 of them. And obviously, because there were 13 different ways that people would pass to come into the temple. But they had, if you can imagine, the bowls with a trumpet-like opening at the top. It was wider than the actual opening that the money went down. It was wider at the top. It was shaped like the end of a trumpet. Amen? And if we built one today, we'd probably shape it like the end of a tuba. Amen? But they shaped it like this. And so the treasury was a place stationed outside the entranceways where people put their offerings. Jesus sat over opposite that area. As a matter of fact, one translation says Jesus sat down opposite the place where the offerings were put. And notice what Jesus did. He beheld how the people cast money into the treasury. Now, if you took this verse of Scripture and you put probably any other name than Jesus there, you'd have to enter the word much. Because probably any other person than Jesus would have noticed how much they put into the treasury. But Jesus didn't so much notice how much. At this point, the Bible is indicating to us that he noticed how the people cast their money into the treasury. Now, when you think about those trumpet-shaped bowls that had the wide openings at the top, then remember what it says in Matthew 6:2 when Jesus said, when you give, do not sound the trumpet before you, as the Pharisees and the hypocrites do. Now, there are some people that believe that literally there were some that when they gave, they had people blast trumpets and parade around with their giving, and that possibly could be the case. But it very much could be the case of this, that Jesus said, when you give, don't do it in such a way that all of your coins and almost every piece of currency during these times, unless it was a note or a loan or a document, was a coin. And Jesus said, don't sound the trumpet. There were some that had that unique ability to drop every coin and let every one of them clang, 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 clang against that trumpet-shaped bowl. Jesus said, when you give, don't sound the trumpet before you. You ever wondered about that verse when Jesus said, let not your right hand know what your left hand is doing? Can I just give you a very simple explanation of what that means? It means there were some that stood there with their money bag or their money, and as they waited to give, they were doing this. Clank, 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 clank. Clank, 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 clank. Clank, 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 clank. Clank, 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 clank. And what would people behind them think? Oh, listen to how much money they're going to put into the treasury. That's what this word simplicity meant. When we give with some simplicity. We do not sound that trumpet. We do not make it sound like we're giving a lot. As a matter of fact, we understand every time we give that Jesus is still, will you listen to what I'm about to say? Jesus is still standing opposite the treasury watching how we give. Now, if you believe Jesus is alive, then you believe that he's still doing today the things that he did when he was on earth. He's just doing it from a better vantage point. Amen? And he's watching how we give. And he knows when we give to our own glory. He knows when we give in such a way that brings more and more attention to ourselves. And notice what happens. The Bible says this poor widow comes. She throws in two mites. Somebody asked me one time, how much is two mites? Well, the Bible tells you right there, it's a farthing. Amen? Is that cleared up? Is that cleared up for you? If I were to write a commentary, I would write a commentary like this. Two mites equals a farthing. Well, Pastor Gary, how much is a farthing? Well, you got to get a smarter preacher than me to know that. But I'll tell you how much it is. The mite was the absolute smallest Jewish coin in circulation at that time. It wasn't gold and it wasn't silver. As a matter of fact, it was made out of bronze. It would be less than the value of our penny today. As a matter of fact, it literally means, the word means a fraction of a penny. A fraction. And this little woman comes up and she puts in what amounts to the fraction of a penny. And look what it says in verses 43 and 44. And what did he do? He called his disciples unto him. That's twice we've seen that in just today's message. He called his disciples. Obviously, giving is a lesson that you never outgrow learning. Giving is a lesson that we have to learn over and over and over again. And he called unto him his disciples, and he said unto them, verily or truly, I say unto you, this poor widow. I want to say something about that word, poor. Do you remember the story in Luke 16 about that man who was sat outside and begged every day? And then the Bible talked about how the beggar died and the rich man died and went down here and the beggar died and went up there. The word that's translated beggar there is the very same word that's translated poor here. This woman was an impoverished woman who probably, listen to what I'm about to say, probably qualified as a beggar in the eyes of the disciples. Probably qualified as a beggar in the eyes of everyone else who was going into the temple and who was depositing their offerings on the way in. She just looked like a beggar. But Jesus says, this widow has cast more in than all they which have cast into the treasury. Let me tell you something I've become convinced of. I've become convinced that that phrase does not mean more than this one or more than that one. I'm convinced that that phrase means when you total everything else that everyone else gave, she gave more than them. Look at the phrase that way and think about it. Why? Because they all did cast in of their abundance. But she of her want did cast in all that she had, even all her living. The very basic money that she would need to pay her utility bill, to keep her kerosene in the tank, to keep groceries in her cabinet, she decided on this day to give it all to God. And you know what happened? God noticed. Amen. You know, people write lots of sequels. I'd love to see the sequel to this story. Amen? Wouldn't you like to see the sequel to this story? Well, if you have the gift of faith, you can write that sequel because you know what God did. Amen? Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. All of these other things shall be added unto you. Can I say something to you about the gift of giving? The gift of giving isn't for the rich. The gift of giving is for the rich in faith. The gift of giving is not for people that have lots of money. The gift of giving is for people who have lots of God and belief that God will give to me. The gift of giving sometimes is given to some people in the church that you absolutely wonder why we're not taking an offering for them, and they're coming to you wanting to know, can we take an offering for these people? The gift of giving, number one, understand poverty. They understand need. They understand lack. And they know that together we can meet that need. I want to say this one thing about giving. Let me tell you why I love the law of the tithe. I love the law of the tithe for this reason. The tithe literally means a tenth part. When you tithe, you give a tenth part. And so let me tell you what that means. That means that when a child gets a dollar and they bring to God a dime, and a man works a week and makes $10,000 and gives God $1,000, He gave a tenth, child gave a tenth, and the dime in God's eyes is as big as the grand. Amen? But let's say perhaps that man that makes $10,000 a week decides to give $1,000, and the child decides to give 15 cents. In God's eyes, the child has given more than the man who gave the thousand. That's what it says about this woman. She did not just come to the temple and give the required amount, but she decided, I'll just give it all. And God noticed. Don't you ever think that your tithe is not important. My mother used to worry about her little retirement check. She'd say, I need to make sure I get my tithe in. She'd say, but it's not much. I know it doesn't help. I said, Mother, you don't understand. You need to understand that if you're giving to God that which He's asked you to give, then in God's eyes, it's a lot. Let's talk about leadership. Look what it says in 1 Timothy 3, 4 and 5, right after Romans 12, 8. Romans 12, 8 says, he that rules with diligence. There are many translations who use the word leadership here because that's what it's talking about. It talks about one that rules well or leads well his own house. Leadership is that special ability that God gives some believers to see needs and to set goals to help the church accomplish God's purposes, but not just accomplish the purposes, but to accomplish them in a harmonious way for the glory of God. Now, there are two ways to go about leadership. You can say, and trust me, sometimes I'll take this over having nothing, amen? Now, I'll explain what I'm about to say. There are some people that have the gift of leadership that say, the church needs to do this and you better do it. I'll take that over nothing, amen? But the gift of leadership is that gift like that parent that rules well. I've watched some fathers rule their children. But I've watched some that even though they ruled their children, they didn't rule them well, amen? I've seen some children be obedient to their father because they were absolutely afraid or terrified of him. And I've seen some be obedient to their father because they absolutely were convinced that he loved them and everything he wanted them to do was for their best interest. That's the difference between just ruling and ruling well. Leadership needs to act in such a way that not only do we know and understand the things the church needs to do to accomplish its purposes, but we want to make sure that we do it in such a way that the church remains in harmony and that we do it joyfully. You know, just don't forget this. The Bible calls us sheep and not cattle. Amen? You drive cattle and you lead sheep. And all I can say to you is this. This hurts, but it's the truth. Dogs do a better job of shepherding than people do. Because a dog works the sheep from the outside and circles them and keeps them in. Our job, well, we'll just push them where they need to be. Well, unfortunately, cattle, if you get one going, a lot of them will follow. You ever seen those trails? Pastures where those milk cows just wear out a rut. Where one goes, you push sheep, and if you got 100 of them, there's 100 different ideas and 100 different ways that they go. Someone has to lead them and keep them together. That's leadership. Let's talk real quick and last about mercy. Look what it says in Romans 12:8. He that shows mercy with cheerfulness. I want to say this to you. It would seem to me that the gifts that we would understand most and be the best at would be the gifts that we ourselves have received. Amen. And we have all received mercy. Every one of us. We have had a loving God look down at an undeserving people and say, I'm going to meet their needs. Anyway, we ought to be good at the things that have been given to us. We ought to be good at loving. We ought to be good at mercy because there is that ability to show empathy and compassion for suffering individuals in the body of Christ. Now, there are some that we go, but there are some that go and they know just what to say, how to say it. Let me tell you something most important about the gift of mercy. People with the gift of mercy know when to say and when to just be. Amen? Just to be there when someone needs them. We have all sensed the presence of God in times when we knew we did not deserve it. We cannot let the church come down till we serve the ones that we think deserve it. The church must come down till we serve one another. We've got to start looking at one another like Jesus looked at those two mites. And we've got to understand the value of people. Look at this verse in Jude. And I put 1:22. There's only one chapter in Jude, so we could just say Jude 22. The Bible says, "Of some have compassion." You see that word compassion? It's the very same word that's translated mercy on he that shows mercy. "And of some have compassion." And look at that next phrase. "Making a difference." Making a difference. I want to tell you a story. I can tell it very quickly. When I was a very young man, I lived near a highway, and all kind of animals would get injured on the highway or whatever and make their way into the yard, and some of them were pitiful shape. But I had an old dog come into the yard one time, and he looked terrible. And it looked like maybe a car had run over just his right rear foot and his tail. And the tail was just broken. It stuck up like this, and then it just hung down. Tail was broken. And not only was it broken, but it had gotten infected, that broken area. And that back leg was, you would think maybe if you tied the leg and the tail together, you could make one good dog out of it. The dog was so thin and so skinny that the first thing I did was get it something to eat. And I got a little bowl of food and I went out on the porch and I set it down. And as the dog began to eat, like it had never seen food before, I just took my hand and I rubbed the dog on the back of the head. And the dog stopped eating and pressed against my hand. Even an old, broken down, stray dog would rather be loved than eat. Mercy is that ability to see beyond physical needs and to see mental, emotional, psychological needs that must be met. When I fed that old dog, I had to remember something my mama used to say when we were children, because I was notorious for wanting to feed everything that came in the yard. Mom would say, "If you feed that dog," what would your mama say? "He'll never leave. If you feed that dog, it'll keep coming back." And every once in a while when I'm praying about the church, you know what I hear my mama say? "If you feed those people, they'll never leave. If you feed those people, they'll keep coming back." When we give them what they need, psychologically, emotionally, spiritually, I'm not talking about just physical needs, I'm talking about what people need. When we give them what they need, they'll keep coming back, they'll never leave. I'd rather be loved than fed. And that's a big statement for me. I said a mouthful. So here's the last slide. Romans 12, 9 through 11. "So let love be without dissimulation." What's that mean? That means you don't decide who you love. "Let love be without dissimulation." Dissimulation would say this: I'll love you, but Not you. I should have started over here. I love you, but not you. That means I gotta love you and not you. You don't do it. If you decide, you know, I'm going to decide who I love, when I love, how I love, then you're loving with dissimulation. And the Bible says, let love be without dissimulation. Let God decide who we love. Amen? Let God decide who we serve. Let God decide how we live. Let God decide what we give. If we would let God make the decisions, church would be the most blessed place to be in all the world. Amen? Let love be without dissimulation. Abhor that which is evil. Cleave to that which is good. There's that word, beneficially good again. Be kind one to another with brotherly love and honor, preferring one another. In other words, let's not see whose spiritual gifts can help me. Let's see what spiritual gift I have that can meet someone else's need. Not slothful in business, fervent in spirit. And there's that word again. Serving the Lord. Do you just notice that when we love without picking and choosing who we love, when we cleave to that which is beneficially good, not just what feels good to me, but what is good for the church, when we are kind to one another in brotherly love, when we put other people's needs in front of our own, the Bible tells us this: we are serving the Lord. Can I make a closing statement? And I'm not going to add to it. If believers are not serving one another, they are not serving the Lord. Amen. I add not a word. Amen, Jimmy. I'm expecting you to serve me this week. Amen. If believers are not serving one another, they're not serving the Lord. When you go to the website this week, you'll notice a last slide on this lesson that gives you some sites you can go to that can help you understand more about spiritual gifts. I put a disclaimer on there. It doesn't mean that I or the church support everything you'll read about on those sites, but there's some good sites that can help you understand spiritual gifts. But I'm going to say this to you, closing. The only way to learn how to truly, fully, completely serve the Lord is to learn how to truly, fully, completely serve one another and then do it. Let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning as people who have experienced your mercy, your compassion, your love, your service, your leadership, your giving. As a matter of fact, everything that you've listed here as a service gift for us are things that you have done for us. There's not a one of us who have not benefited from all of these things at your very hand. And now you ask us to allow others to benefit from what you have given us, from our hand, from our heart, from our head. I pray, God, that you would help us to understand service gifts, to know the value of serving one another, of not wondering when the church is going to meet my need, but wondering how I can be a part in meeting the needs of others in the church. Father, I ask this morning for anyone who might be here who just really needs to go back and touch first base and just really understand first and foremost about being saved. So hard to understand serving if you're not saved. It's hard to understand putting others first if you don't understand how Christ put me first, us first, gave himself in our place. So I pray that we come to an understanding about salvation. If there's anyone here today who doesn't understand salvation, they don't have to leave here that way today. They could come down this aisle. Someone could take them to a private place and help them understand salvation. They can contact me during the week and I'll set a time to meet with them and help them understand salvation. And the same is true about what we've said today about service. Father, we give an invitation this morning and not really sure even how to do it, or what you want done, but we offer it for any who need to make some kind of response for you. Whatever it might be, I pray that we would be responsive to you today in Christ's name. Amen.